Have you ever felt an earthquake? Even if you haven't, you've certainly read a newspaper article about one, such as this one from the year 2004. Quake shakes South Baden. Police receive thousands of calls. Minimal damage. A quake measuring 5.4 on the Richter scale unceremoniously woke thousands of people in South Baden and the surrounding region on Saturday night. The epicenter was located near Waldkirch. The quake were perceptible up to 250 kilometers away. Hello and welcome. In this video, I will be giving you a brief introduction to the topic of earthquakes. You will learn what an earthquake actually is, which parameters are used to describe its strength, and why earthquake research or seismology is conducted. The earthquake in Waldkirch near Freiburg will serve as an example in this case, and if you have felt an earthquake in Germany in the past, it might have been this one. The earthquake on December 5, 2004 is described using the following scientific parameters. It had a magnitude of 5.4, a maximum intensity of 6, and occurred at a depth of 12 kilometers. The epicenter was located near Waldkirch, and it was perceptible within a radius of 250 kilometers, which encompassed Frankfurt, Munich, France, and all the way down to southern Switzerland. But wait a moment. What do the following mean? Magnitude, maximum intensity, epicenter, and radius of perceptibility? To answer that, I first need to explain to you how an earthquake occurs. Earthquakes take place under the Earth. Shallow quakes take place 1 to 5 kilometers under the Earth's surface, while deep-focus earthquakes occur at depths of up to 600 kilometers. An earthquake occurs when two sections of rock slide past each other. This movement releases energy that is radiated in the form of elastic waves. Now, let's talk about magnitude. In seismology, magnitude describes the intensity of the earthquake underground. It depends on the size of the rupture plane and the extent of the displacement along it. In the media, such as our newspaper article, they often speak of the magnitude on the Richter scale, which is named after Charles Richter, who, together with Benno Gutenberg, developed this scale in the 1930s for describing earthquakes in California. Today, the strength of earthquakes is calculated using modern global magnitude scales, however, the name has remained. A larger magnitude means that the seismic waves radiate more energy, and it is described using a logarithmic scale. This means that a magnitude 6 earthquake releases around 1,000 times as much energy as a magnitude 4 quake. Unlike the magnitude, the intensity of a quake describes its effects on the Earth's surface. It indicates whether the earthquake was perceptible, if cracks occurred in the walls of buildings, or even if building sections collapsed. An intensity of 3 means that the tremors may be felt by a few people, while a value of 4 means that many people will feel it. At an intensity of 5, small objects are already falling over in your apartment, and at a value of 6, damage in the form of cracks in the plaster and in walls may occur. But let's return to the Waldkirch earthquake in the year 2004. How big was the contact or rupture plane in the displacement underground? A magnitude of 5.4 occurs when, along a rupture plane measuring several kilometers, the rock sections involved are displaced by 10 to 20 centimeters. Shown here is a map of the Upper Rhine Graben between Basel and Frankfurt. It is one of the active earthquake areas in Germany. The illustration shows all known quakes according to the magnitude. Large circles indicate large quakes with a magnitude of 5 to 6, while small circles indicate magnitudes of up to 1, which can only be measured using sensitive seismometers and cannot be felt. Hence, the Waldkirch earthquake was a relatively major seismic event for German standards, one that is experienced by this region only about once every 200 years on average. Now let's talk about the intensity of this rare event. The maximum intensity of an earthquake is experienced in the area around the epicenter. The epicenter is the exact point on the Earth's surface located vertically above the rupture plane, which is underground. In the case of Altkirch, minor building damage such as cracks in walls occurred, which corresponds to an intensity of 6. The radius of perceptibility corresponds to the average distance from the epicenter within which the quake can be felt by humans and corresponds to an intensity of 3. You can certainly imagine that, in this case, the maximum intensity depends on both the magnitude, that means the force on the ground, as well as the depth of the earthquake. Deep earthquakes are less strongly felt on the Earth's surface than shallow quakes of the same magnitude. Hence, if the Waldkirch quake had taken place at a shallower depth, the damage, and thus the maximum intensity, would have been greater. The radius of perceptibility, on the other hand, would have been smaller. Intensities and magnitudes are important for estimating the danger that future earthquakes pose. Seismologists collect this information from a large number of earthquakes and use it to calculate seismic hazards. Statistical methods are used for this purpose, which allow the average frequency of earthquakes for individual regions to be determined. However, seismology is not only concerned with the effects on the Earth's surface. What other purposes does the observation of earthquakes serve? Earthquakes radiate elastic waves that travel along the Earth's surface or through the interior of the Earth. Seismometers record the resulting ground motion all over the Earth. Information on how the waves propagate and how they change helps us to learn more about the structural configuration of what is under the surface. Important observations in this case include the arrival times of seismic waves. Shown here is a seismogram of the Waldkirch earthquake, which was recorded at the BFO Seismic Observatory in the Black Forest, 35 kilometers away. You can clearly see the initial onset of the seismic P wave approximately 7 seconds after the earthquake, and the later arrival of other wave types, such as the S wave. This schematic illustration shows how we can learn more about what's beneath the Earth's surface via a combination of various seismometers. Seismometers on the Earth's surface are shown as triangles in this diagram, and a zone with a low propagation velocity is located beneath the surface. As an example, seismic waves from two earthquakes are shown in red and blue. The waves shown as dotted lines now arrive later than expected from both directions at certain seismometers. This allows us to localize the underground heterogeneous zone. We call this principle tomography. At the beginning of the 20th century, the first few seismologists began using this method to evaluate strong earthquakes worldwide. Using the arrival times of the seismic waves, they were able to generate a rough map of the Earth's structure consisting of the core, the mantle, and the crust. At the bottom left is a model of the Earth from the year 1929, in which the Earth core is already shown at its correct size. In addition, various propagation paths through the Earth are also shown. Today, with the help of sensitive seismometers, it is also possible to evaluate even small earthquakes. Furthermore, in addition to the arrival times of the seismic waves, their form is now also evaluated and modeled using high-performance computers. This makes it possible to investigate small-scale three-dimensional structures such as volcanoes, plate boundaries and underground mountain routes, or even the source of earthquakes. The same methods become economically relevant when artificial sources of tremors are used. Important areas of application in this case include exploring for crude oil and natural gas, the search for raw materials in general, as well as investigation of construction sites and geological exploration before building a tunnel. As you can see, there are diverse areas of application for seismic methods, both in scientific and economic contexts. So let me summarize. The observation and recording of earthquakes using seismometers is important in order to, on the one hand, estimate future seismic hazards. For this purpose, information on the magnitude, the maximum intensity, and the radius of perceptibility of various earthquakes is necessary. On the other hand, earthquake measurements allow us to determine the structure of the Earth on both large and small spatial scales by analyzing the arrival times and the form of the seismic waves. Hence, we can learn from quakes like the one in Waldkirch on December 5, 2004 and use the information that they provide for the benefit of society and science. This allows us to better estimate hazards posed by earthquakes and better understand the processes taking place in the Earth.